Inside the Magic Show number 367 for April 15th, 2012.
Hello again. We're just about ready to hit the track, so please make sure your safety belts are securely fastened, as they always should be in your vehicle.
Test sequence is downloading, and we're clear for dispatch.
Okay, let's move them ahead for test one.
It is Sunday, April 15th, 2012. This is show 367 of Inside the Magic, and as always, I'm your host, Ricky Briganti. We do have another great show, packed with Disney and theme park news and a whole lot more fun. And before we get started with all of that, I invite you to visit our website over at insidethemagic.net. There you'll find all of our podcasts, videos, photos, news, articles, and so much more. And if you ever have any news, tips, questions, comments, anything else you want to say, you can always write to me at ricky@insidethemagic.net via email, or you can call and leave a message at 407-494-4ITM. That's 4486. And now, let's get on with the show. This week's episode of Inside the Magic is brought to you by Magical Travel. The perfect recipe for a great vacation is free dining at Walt Disney World right here in Florida. It's available for most stays, for most nights from 8:25 through 9:27. That's August 25th through September 27th. Offer must be booked, though, by May 18th. So you got just over a month to do that. So hurry for the best resort availability. And summer room discounts are also available. You're going to want to check with Magical Travel for rates and dates by calling them at 866-207-8387 or visit them online at magicaltravel.com to receive a free price quote. And be sure to mention Inside the Magic to receive your free Disney gift card for qualifying bookings when you book your Disney vacation with Magical Travel. And by Audible, get a free audiobook download over at audibletrial.com/insidethemagic. Of course, you get a 30-day trial as well to get access to over 85,000 titles to choose from for your iPod or any other MP3 player. And of course, thanks very much to listeners and viewers like you for your donations, monthly recurring donations, or just single donations, or clicking through the affiliate links. It's all very much appreciated. So I thank you very much for that. And now, let's get started with our trip around the world.
Let's see what you're made of, program.
So let's jump right into the news this week. Today, April 15th, 2012, is certainly a date that is, well, it's full of good things and it's full of bad things, mostly bad things in my opinion. Let's start out right out at Disneyland. Of course, you're hearing some Tron music here in the background, and that's because, well, ElecTRONica, unfortunately, over at Disney California Adventure is going into immediate deresolution. Today, April 15th, 2012, is the final day for the portal to be open at that theme park at Disneyland Resort. The grid will close forever, and its replacement will be the Alice in Wonderland themed Mad Tea Party, inspired by Tim Burton's Alice in Wonderland, coming up in a couple of months in June. I've been enjoying ElecTRONica for the past year and a half that it has been around, and well, Flynn still lives on. There is a back door over at InsideTheMagic.net. I have posted a complete ElecTRONica tribute to this nighttime party that is themed around Tron and Tron Legacy. And so if you want to relive ElecTRONica after it ends tonight, then you're going to want to head over to the website, check out our videos and lots of photos from throughout the event that I've been enjoying so much, and I know so many others have as well. One footnote to the whole thing is I received an email a few days ago from somebody named Jonathan, who let me know that a cast member working over at Flynn's Arcade in ElecTRONica said that Flynn's Arcade may stick around past ElecTRONica. I haven't heard anything official like that from Disney, so we'll chalk that up as a rumor at this point, but I'd certainly like to see that happen. Doesn't seem likely. Seems like Mad Tea Party will certainly be moving in and really taking over there, but we will have to just wait and see what happens there. But ElecTRONica definitely is having its last day today. And as a little tribute to that here on the show, I'm not going to be sharing a lot of ElecTRONica, but you will enjoy some more Tron music here in the background. So something else is going to be closing soon out at Disneyland, and it was announced this week. It was actually previously known that this was going to be happening, but Disney set a firm date for the end of Carnation Plaza Gardens. It's going to be closing April 30th, 2012. That's going to be the last day of operation for the Carnation Plaza Gardens, which is right near Sleeping Beauty Castle at Disneyland in California. It's, of course, been home to swing dancing parties for many, many decades. Now, it's a big piece of Disneyland history. In fact, dating back to decades and decades ago, Walt Disney himself, in a fairly famous picture, has been seen smiling and dancing and really enjoying Carnation Plaza Gardens. But Disneyland has decided to move on from there, and soon it will become Fantasy Fair, which they're describing as an enchanted village square that will immerse guests into stories of their favorite princesses. It's going to include Tangled Tower and a Royal Princess Hall and princess meet and greets and a Fantasy Fair stage where they'll put on the stories of fairy tale heroes and heroines. And then at night, Disney says the dancing from Carnation Plaza Gardens will still be around the Fantasy Fair stage, though not quite in the same form, because of course Carnation Plaza Gardens will no longer be there. In the meantime, Disney will be holding that dancing out at Downtown Disney on the West Side stage beginning May 5th. Of course, there are still two more times for you to enjoy the Jump Jive Boogie Swing Party on each Saturday that's remaining this month before it gets bumped to Downtown Disney in May. Not good news for those who have been fans of that area of the park for many, many decades now, but change is imminent, and you just have to deal with it. So let's jump over here to Orlando now, where a quick bit of news from the Magic Kingdom that I just came across a little while ago, right before sitting down to record this week's show. Over in Adventureland at the Magic Kingdom, the Sunshine Tree Terrace has been very much renovated. It's got a lot of new design elements, a new menu, offering something called a citrus swirl that everybody is very much crazy about. And then apparently, as of this weekend, they have now brought back the orange bird character from many years ago in the form of sippy cups that you can get from the Sunshine Tree Terrace. In addition, there seems to be an orange bird up on the sign for the Sunshine Tree Terrace. However, it is not visible yet. For some reason, Disney hasn't had an official unveiling of that quite yet, but it seems the orange bird is back at Walt Disney World. For those who were fans, I have no personal connection to the orange bird. I think I skipped that in the world of Disney history. Maybe it was a little bit before my time in the world of Disney, but for those of you who feel nostalgic about that orange bird character, well, seems like he is indeed back. But something that, it will be back in a few months, but for now is, again, as I said, today is an important day for Disney. Not only is it at the end of ElecTRONica, but out here in Orlando at Walt Disney World is also the last day for Test Track, as we know it, over at Epcot. As it has existed since it first opened in late 1998, it's going to close officially tomorrow, April 16th, and will be transformed into the Chevrolet Design Center at Epcot, or I've actually seen it called the Chevrolet Design Studio at Epcot as well, so I'm not sure if center or studio is the correct word. Maybe they're still trying to figure that out. It's going to reopen in fall 2012, and apparently the ride itself is going to be pretty much the same. They're not making any drastic changes to the track of Test Track, but the overall theme is going to be different. Rather than focusing on the theme of testing cars, they're going to be focusing on the theme of designing and building new cars. There's going to be interactive workstations where guests will design custom vehicles, and then you'll ride in a new sim car ride vehicle, which those of you watching the video version of this can see one of the updated versions of a Test Track car that is currently making its way around the track, sort of a new high-tech blue motif. And then after you've gone through the ride in your sim car, using your design as inspiration somehow in the new version of the attraction, then in the post show there will be a score based on your design and some other interactive features as well. Of course, so Test Track isn't really necessarily going away. It's just changing and getting kind of a redesign, a sort of similar to how it worked for Spaceship Earth, gets sort of an update, though this seems to be more of an overhaul than ever before. Certainly more than Spaceship Earth has received. In the meantime, Epcot's going to be putting on some additional entertainment for those who are attending the park while Test Track is down for the next few months. Getting the redesign apparently beginning tomorrow morning, April 16th, the Test Track All-Stars, an acapella singing group, will be performing in front of the Test Track Pavilion, which will be closed. They'll be singing travel-themed songs. And then on a trial basis, as Disney is putting it, the Land Pavilion is going to be open until 10 p.m. each night, which is an hour past normal park hours and 3 hours past most of the Future World operating hours. So this means until 10 p.m., guests will have access to Soarin', Circle of Life, Living with the Land, merchandise locations, food and beverage offerings, as well as the character spot will be open until 10 p.m. So some additional entertainment for those going to Epcot this summer while Test Track is closed for its refurbishment to become that Chevrolet Design Center. We'll be talking a little bit more about Test Track a little bit later in this show as well. Speaking of driving experiences, here's a rather pricey one that's very limited for those of you who have some big bucks to spare. Over at the Exotic Driving Experience, which we talked about a couple of months ago here on the show when it made its debut at the Walt Disney World Speedway, they've announced an upcoming VIP day with Christian Fittipaldi, who is a racer who has competed in one of the few drivers who has competed in every major racing series, IndyCar, NASCAR, etc., etc. And he was there on hand for the opening of the Exotic Driving Experience a couple of months ago. We had an interview with him. Well, now he's coming back. He's going to be offering 24 people 4 8-lap driving experiences where you get behind the wheel and you take a thrill ride with him as well. It's $2,000 a person for this special event that's going to take place on June 8th. It's also going to include breakfast or lunch, souvenir plaque, in-car video, and merchandise autographed by Christian Fittipaldi. If you've got $2,000 to spare, and this sounds like an exciting experience for you, you're going to want to head to exoticdriving.com/offers/VIP. And if anyone out there does it, let me know how it is. So moving away from there to the world of resorts now, an interesting new Disney Movie Rewards reward popped up this week. Disney's Art of Animation Resort, of course, is grand opening in about a month and a half from now, at the end of May. And Disney Movie Rewards, if you've been collecting those points with Disney DVDs and Blu-rays and all of that, if you have 22,000 points to spare, you can actually redeem those for 3 nights at the Art of Animation Resort out here at Walt Disney World. So it's a lot of points. I have a lot of Disney movies and I'm nowhere near 22,000 points, but I have seen a few people online say they have reached that point level, but I don't know if it's worth redeeming all those points for that. You could probably just book 3 nights there for less, but anyway, I guess it's free. So, speaking of the Art of Animation Resort, Disney also this week offered a closer look into the Landscape of Flavors food court menu that's going to be at Disney's Art of Animation Resort. The pictures that they showed off, a lot of people who saw them on the Disney Parks blog were saying they look rather beige in color. They don't necessarily look like the most colorful food that you would expect coming out of a Disney's Art of Animation Resort, but regardless, the menu is going to include some create-your-own burgers. Choose from beef, chicken, or veggie burgers with lots of toppings. There's going to be 4 on-stage tandoor ovens that'll feature bread and roasted chicken, shrimp, sausage, acorn squash, and other veggies with non-Indian bread. There's also going to be a Mongolian grill that is going to be 3 feet in diameter in this food court. That's going to feature for breakfast challah bread, French toast, as well as for lunch and dinner, some grilled beef and fish. And throughout the food court, they're going to offer some healthier options like buckwheat waffles and pasta, multigrain rice, low-fat smoothies, egg white frittatas, make your own yogurt parfaits. But then for those who don't necessarily want the healthier dining experience, you'll still be able to get the pizza and fries and chocolate chip pancakes and all those goodies. In addition, they're going to have gelato and coffee drinks and, So it's definitely a different sort of flavor profile, if you will, over at the Art of Animation Resort. They're looking to change things up, and we'll see how well received that is for the value resort or value hotel crowd that will be staying at that when it begins its grand opening as of May 31st for its first wing. Let's turn back to Disneyland now, where this was an interesting announcement this week. Disneyland Resort has begun accepting dining reservations as well as reservations for the Bibbidi Bobbidi Boutique and Studio Disney 365 via email. You can now send an email to dine@disneyland.com, and if you send the email between 7 a.m. and 9 p.m., it'll be processed the same day, 7 days a week. After hours, emails will be reviewed the next day, and you'll get your dining reservation. They'll email you back with a confirmation. You have to email them with the name of the restaurant that, or experience that you'd like, the reservation date and the meal period if it's dining, breakfast, lunch, or dinner, the number of guests in your party, and your name and your phone number. So that's definitely, an interesting sort of dining experience there, or rather a reservation experience. And then in addition, Disney noted, they must be getting a lot of inquiries for this, that the upcoming opening of the Carthay Circle restaurant in the Carthay Circle Theater at Disney California Adventure, of course it's not open yet, it's opening June 15th, reservations are not available yet. So I would imagine Disney's been getting a lot of calls related to that. And yeah, so it's not available quite yet, but I'm sure Disney will let everybody know when you are able to book reservations for that new restaurant when it opens on June 15th, along with Buena Vista Street and Cars Land and well, many other experiences. New, kind of finishing up the billion-dollar five-year renovation project over at Disney California Adventure. So I want to put in another mention here about the Disney Fantasy, the newest Disney Cruise Line ship. Of course, something I've been talking about and writing about for several weeks now since it made its inaugural voyage about 3 weeks ago. This week, I did finally post the last series of Disney Fantasy articles and all of the photos that I took and all the videos. I think it ended up being around 49 videos, more than 3 hours of video from onboard the ship. New articles from the Disney Fantasy this week include a look at the sailing away from Port Canaveral, returning the final character-filled See You Real Soon show, the Shutters the Shutters shop on board, which has digital photography available, where you can review your pictures and get prints and all of that, enchanted art and artwork on the ship, reviews of the Royal Court and Palo restaurants, the mini golf that's on board the ship, the kids areas, look at the character meet and greets available there, Castaway Key Cabana, and also my experience with the salon, the spa, rather, the Senses Spa on board. So if you're interested in any of that, head on over to InsideTheMagic.net to see everything that I've posted from the Disney Fantasy. It's been fun writing about it for the last 3 weeks, but I'm glad it's done, and now it's a pretty comprehensive look at the newest Disney Cruise Line ship that you can check out over at InsideTheMagic.net. Let's turn away from the world of Disney now here for something that finally has been confirmed for Universal Studios Hollywood just a week ago. May 25th of this year, just over a month from now, is going to be the official opening date for Transformers The Ride 3D. Actually, the night before is going to be a big red carpet event out at Universal Studios Hollywood, and then May 25th will indeed be the official opening, as it was rumored for quite some time, so looking forward to seeing that. And speaking of Universal, actually back out here to Orlando at Universal Orlando, they've announced some of their summer concert series, which is kind of odd that they only announced a little bit of it. Maybe they haven't signed all the acts for it yet, but it's going to begin June 9th with Nickelodeon's cast of Victorious. They're going to be appearing and singing and all of that, and then a week later on June 16th will be ZZ Top and Three Doors Down. They're promising more concerts through July, but we don't know who those acts are going to be quite yet. And Universal Parks and Resorts apparently are set to be building a new indoor theme park in Moscow, Russia. It's going to be part of a 37-acre sports and entertainment complex called Galactica Park. Apparently, not only is it going to have a traditional sort of Universal park, but indoors it's also going to have a water park and a version of City Walk, and there's going to be hotels and an arena, and I don't know, seems like a major project that's going to be unfolding for several billion dollars over the next few years. Universal didn't really have much more to say about it other than apparently that it is happening. Sticking with overseas, but now back to the world of Disney, where, of course, recently we mentioned Disneyland Resort Paris was celebrating their 20th anniversary. They recently debuted their new Disney Dreams Nighttime Castle show. Well, they officially marked the 20-year moment this week. The CEO welcomed everybody, and then there was a flash mob of 2,000 Disneyland Paris cast members down Main Street USA at the Disneyland Paris Park. The French Air Force aerobatic team also traced a number 20 in the sky up over the park, and there was a speech by Walt Disney Imagineer Tony Baxter as well. So congrats to Disneyland Paris for making it to 20 years. So let's move on to the world of movies now, where this week the Walt Disney Studios set a release date for the upcoming film called Maleficent, starring Angelina Jolie. It's going to be coming out on March 14th of 2014, so a couple of years away still. It's going to follow the origins of the character of Maleficent from Sleeping Beauty, of course, and what led her to curse Princess Aurora in the beginning of that film. And it looks like the reports are recirculating, resurfacing once again, courtesy of Variety, that Tom Hanks is in talks to play Walt Disney in an upcoming movie about the making of Mary Poppins. Emma Thompson apparently will be playing Poppins author P.L. Travers. It is not confirmed. It is not official. Disney hasn't announced it yet, but the rumors and the talks keep circulating repeatedly. I may have even mentioned it a few weeks ago, the first time the news made its way around. We'll have to wait and see if indeed Mr. Hanks will be playing Walt Disney on the big screen. And some fun Muppets news came out just yesterday. I believe the director of the recent The Muppets movie, James Bobin, has once again teamed up with co-writer Nicholas Stoller. They've begun writing the script for the next Muppet movies. In fact, they've already written 13 pages of it, apparently. They're going to feature some new Muppets. Jason Segel is not going to be heavily involved this time around. They said he might make a cameo in the film as his Gary character, but apparently the Gary storyline has really wrapped up. They left it neatly at the end of The Muppets, and they don't plan on continuing that. They're going to go through a whole new caper, as they're calling it, in the next Muppets film. So that's probably a couple of years away now. Maybe next year, summer, I think 2013 is really when Disney is looking to have the next Muppets movie come out. But we will have to just kind of follow that and see what it's going to be all about. I really enjoyed, of course, the recent Muppets movie, so I look forward to another. And in the world of Marvel, which of course Disney owns now, they just had their world premiere for the upcoming movie The Avengers this week. Just a few nights ago at El Capitan Theater in Hollywood was the big red carpet event with all the stars from The Avengers on hand, along with a lot of other celebrity guests. I've posted some video highlights from The Avengers world premiere over at InsideTheMagic.net and on our YouTube channel. So if you're a fan of the Avengers, definitely want to check that out. Speaking of the Avengers, I also received an email from a listener named Dave in response to a recent comment that I made. I had mentioned the announcement of Captain America 2 being a couple of years away till 2014. I said that that's how long fans will have to wait to see the follow-up to the Avengers. But Dave wrote, "I don't want to be the correction guy, but when you were talking about the release date of Captain America 2, you said it will be released in 2014 and fans of the Avengers would have to wait 2 years for the next chapter. I wanted to point out that Iron Man 3 and Thor 2 are both scheduled for release next year in May and November, respectively." Well, Dave, good point. I definitely should have mentioned that here. However, the reason I said it in the way that I did is because apparently Captain America 2 is going to be a direct follow-up to the Avengers movie, which is coming out just a few weeks from now, in early May, May 4th, I believe. And so they said the storyline from the Avengers is going to continue directly into Captain America 2, whereas Iron Man 3 and Thor 2 apparently are going to be kind of on their own, in their own sort of films. I'm sure there will be tie-ins, but, you know, anyway, so that's what I meant by that. But yes, lots of Marvel and Avengers movies coming up, and whether or not everybody still feels that Disney That the whole Marvel thing and the Avengers and all of that is Disney or not. Well, it is. You know what? Disney owns Marvel now. It's on the Avenger rail, the Avengers wrapped monorail. Eventually, I imagine the Marvel characters will work their way into Disney theme parks somewhere, if not in the United States, then somewhere else in the world. And it's just kind of one of those facts that everybody's going to have to get used to, which I am starting to warm up to the idea that Marvel characters are indeed now Disney characters as well. And speaking of continuing down that line, here's yet another Disney tie-in to the Marvel Universe. Disney Publishing Worldwide just released two new storybook apps this week on the iTunes App Store, and they are following the Marvel Origins series, and they're narrated by comic legend Stan Lee. They are Avengers Origins Hulk and Avengers Origins Assemble, and they are $1.99 each. So here's something that is distinctly Disney. The Newsies, the musical, opened recently on Broadway, and Inside the Magic listener Diane sent in a quick review of the show. She had a chance to check it out. She wrote, "The talented ensemble brims with energy and enthusiasm, and the sheer athleticism of Christopher Gattelli's choreography is amazing to watch. The new songs added to the score by Alan Menken and Jack Feldman improve the story, as do the changes made to the story in Harvey Fierstein's book. It will be nominated for the Tony Award for Best Musical, although it will be a tight race with the musical once for the award. Currently, it's being advertised as a limited engagement. It has already been extended through August 19th, 2012. Do not be surprised if it gets another extension once award season starts." And Diane also wrote up a full review of the show over on her blog at theaccidentalthespian.blogspot.com. So if you want to read more of her thoughts on the Newsies musical from Disney, you can visit her blog as well. Now, in the world of D23, a couple of bits of news came out this week. There's some new discounts for D23 members. D23, of course, is the Disney official fan club, and the new discounts for D23 members include a member-only discount price for Disney's Broadway production, Peter and the Star Catcher, as well as a 10% discount on any chocolate purchases at Ghirardelli Chocolate Company, either online or at Downtown Disney out here at Walt Disney World, or at Disney California Adventure when that opens pretty soon. And then 10% off at Ride Makers locations as well as online. A discounted rate at the Pirates Dinner Adventure in Buena Park, California. Little mismatched. You get 15% off there at Disneyland in Walt Disney World. There's some Zumba fitness offers for D23 members. A VIP membership to Live 365 Internet Radio. And a 10% off purchases of $65 or more at Disney Store locations or DisneyStore.com through June 30th. So some good discounts there for those of you who are D23 members. And also this week, the D23 online show Disney Geek returned online, and it's featuring some new episodes as well as a new look and some new hosts, which not everybody is entirely thrilled with so far, the new hosts. They are Carmen Capone, the editor-in-chief of D23's quarterly magazine, Disney 23, as well as Billy Stanek, who is D23's web content editor. The new version of the Disney Geek show is bi-weekly. It is aired online, or it comes out online on Wednesdays and Fridays, really every other Wednesdays and Fridays. So Jeffrey Epstein is still a producer of the show. He was the previous host of the Disney Geek show. And that's it for your news from around the world this week. I've got a rather long tip to share here that just came in the other day from Drew, but it's an interesting one. Now, I will preface this by saying this is not an advertisement. This is not a paid anything, but it sort of borders on that sort of topic, so I wanted to say that first. Drew writes, "We visited Walt Disney World last spring, my first time since I was in the college program almost 10 years ago, in inexcusable interim, and my wife's first visit ever. We had a fantastic time, stayed at the enjoyable Pop Century Resort, and spent six glorious days touring the parks, it was fun to see how things have changed since I worked there, and even more fun to see how things have stayed just the same. I love the attractions that are new to the last decade. It was voted American Idol finalist in the evening show, and even took one day visit to be thoroughly amazed by the Wizarding World of Harry Potter. Now on to my tip. Even those familiar with Disney traveling, I think it is a good idea to contact a travel agent, and in our case, I contacted Inside the Magic sponsor, Magical Travel. Like I said, I'm no stranger to the Disney parks, so I hesitated, thinking that they wouldn't really be able to offer any much by the way of things I didn't already know or couldn't find out on my own. After all, I was a cast member once myself. Surely, I could plan a vacation on my own. This may be largely true, but I found it was still worthwhile to contact them for tips and feedback about accommodations, travel to and from Universal, dining, and other preparations. Even if you don't really need much help in these areas, it was still very convenient to have one contact for all of your travel questions, including airline ticketing and hotel information and other incidental travel. Our agent Julie was incredibly helpful and personable, and didn't try to persuade us in any direction, just helped us to plan and have the vacation that we wanted. We did end up doing a lot of planning on our own, but it was still nice to know that there was a contact if anything went wrong with our itinerary. So just a plug, and no, I promise I wasn't put up to this by anyone, to use Magical Travel or any travel agent. Not only are they helpful and resourceful, but with Magical Travel, you get a Disney gift card for booking through them. Really, what can you lose? Well, Drew, definitely some good points there. As you said, you weren't paid to say that or anything, and I wasn't either. And it's not even specific just to our sponsor, Magical Travel, but really any travel agency. It is an interesting sort of notion there, because even if you are a big Disney fan, which if you're listening to this podcast or you're watching it, you certainly are, you can still get some extra help from a travel agency, and it doesn't cost anything for anyone. You might as well kind of talk your way through your trip with somebody else, and maybe they can throw out some ideas that you otherwise wouldn't have thought of, where to stay, where to eat, what to book, how to get from here to there. Certainly, always good to have some extra heads in there, especially if you're going to be spending thousands of dollars on a trip. Why not get some additional advice for free? So, a good tip there. Everyone else, send your tips into tips@insidethemagic.net. Now, before we get to this week's feature, that wasn't an advertisement, but this is. It is. I've got to put in a word about one of our other sponsors, that is Theme Park Connection. If you haven't checked out Theme Park Connection yet and you are a Disney collector, you're definitely missing out. At ThemeParkConnection.com is where you will find their eBay store, where you can browse through a lot of rare and unique Disney items that they have for sale. In addition, if you're in the Orlando area, whether you're visiting here or you're a local, you can stop by their Winter Garden, Florida actual physical store to browse through their very large and constantly expanding warehouse full of hundreds and hundreds of Disney items. You can even bring your own Disney items to sell to them there as well. They'll give you cash on the spot. Lots of great costumes and signs and really rare pieces from the parks that you really can't get anywhere else. And, their warehouse has been growing and growing and definitely looks fantastic. It's only 15 minutes north of the Magic Kingdom or so. So definitely check it out over at ThemeParkConnection.com.
Please remain behind the yellow stripes until your test vehicle comes to a complete stop. Watch your step as you enter the vehicle.
So as I said, near the top of the show, today, April 15th, 2012, is the last day of operation for Test Track, as we have known it for, 14 years or so now. It's been an integral piece of the Epcot experience in Future World for so many years, but after today, it's going to be closing and becoming the Chevrolet Design Center or Chevrolet Design Studio or something, and Test Track may still be worked into the name there somewhere, but regardless, today is indeed the last day for anybody to head to Epcot to ride it. And I actually said my goodbyes to Test Track just a couple of days ago, where I went over there specifically with the purpose of that. I went through the ride several times in a row, hung out in the queue, hung out in the pre-show areas, and really wanted to capture everything that has been Test Track for so long. And really, when I started going to Walt Disney World on my own for the first time was really in the late 90s. And it was right around the time that Test Track was gearing up, so to speak, to open. And there were some delays in the initial opening of Test Track, but ultimately it did get up and running. And Test Track has really been a major part of my Walt Disney World memories and my Walt Disney World experiences over the years. So while it's not my favorite attraction in the world, it's definitely a part of my memories of Walt Disney World, and I wanted to make sure to capture all of that going forward, because in the future, it won't be like it has been for so many years now. So you can visit InsideTheMagic.net in the coming days for a sort of tribute to Test Track as it has existed for the past 14 years, but I wanted to share also something on this week's show as well, something you know, we haven't done in quite a while, which is just a straight binaural journey through an attraction. This is actually going to start outside the attraction itself, outside Test Track, work its way a little bit through the queue. I didn't walk through the entire queue because it's just this sort of music you're hearing in the background now for a while. Just a little hint of that, and then we can work our way through the pre-show that everybody loves from Test Track. Very funny, very informative, sort of a classic Disney pre-show video there, and then of course go on a ride on Test Track as well one last time before it closes to become this Chevrolet Design Center. So, of course, with any binaural experience here on Inside the Magic, I do encourage you to put on your headphones for the most enjoyment, to really make you feel like you are sitting there on the attraction itself. And so now let's turn down the Test Track music in the background here. And without further ado, head on over to Epcot to experience Test Track.
GM test facilities all over the world. Let's put up the 26-8 grade.
You got it.
Okay, we're going to start you off on an accelerated hill climb. Now, these steep grades give us a chance to evaluate the effects of heat and stress on your engine and on the transmission.
Twisted germ blocks.
Let's put up the blocks, German and Belgian. Next, your vehicle is going to go over a variety of rough road surfaces. These are designed to test the integrity of the suspension and the chassis.
Get a bit bumpy.
Yeah. Next, you're going to see and feel what it's like when your brakes lock up and you lose control of the steering. That's a good feeling, but hang in there because we're going to do the test one more time, this time with the ABS or the anti-lock brakes.
Okay. All right. What's next?
Let's do some environmental tests. Put up 2, 5, and 7.
7?
Yeah, 7.
Okay.
After that, we're going to subject your vehicle to some extremes in temperature, as well as corrosive conditions, to see how it handles nature's worst. And finally, we'll take you out for some handling runs. Let's do the cornering. I'm going to send you through some hairpin turns, and then we'll take you out and do the high-speed loops. And depending on how your vehicle and you hold up, throw a few surprise tests in there.
Surprise test?
Yeah. Pick one. Now, if this whole routine seems a bit extreme, you're absolutely right. That's what a test track is all about. The cars you drive at home are made up of over 15,000 different parts, and every one of them has to pass the test under very extreme conditions before we ever let it off that test track and out onto the road. Now, as you can imagine, safety is a big concern of ours, so we're going to insist that you buckle up your safety belt securely.
You'll be glad you did. We're ready.
Oh, great. Well, Sherry says we're ready, so we'll see you out there on the test track.
Good luck. Have a good ride.
Check is around the corner. For your safety, remain seated with your hands, arms, feet, and legs inside the vehicle and supervise children. Thank you.
La estación de control de cinturones de seguridad está a la vuelta de la esquina. Por su seguridad, mantenga sus manos, brazos, pies y piernas dentro del vehículo y cuida a los niños.
Proceed to the rough road tests.
You got it.
Okay, I'm going to take you right up to the cones, hit the brakes, and see if I can steer you through. Hold on.
We're back on track.
Let's do that other sequence.
Okay, let's try it again, this time with the anti-lock brakes.
ABS reactivated. Braking!
All right, that's the way it ought to be. You see how ABS lets you keep control of the vehicle while braking? Let's demonstrate some extreme test conditions.
Okay.
Did you remember to turn off those robots?
Clear for track course A.
Let's pick up the pace.
Increasing speed, 10%.
Are you seeing an increase in lateral forces?
Sure am.
Accelerating.
As long as they're heated up, let's grab a thermal image.
Will do. Camera's on. Looks like all components are well within test parameters.
Well, all right. That completes our test schedule. Let's download the data.
OnStar vehicle diagnostics complete.
Hey, thanks for being such a great test crew. Come back and ride anytime. Bye now.
Watch your step when exiting the vehicle, and remember to take all your personal belongings.
And there you have it, a ride on Test Track on its, a couple of days before its final day of operation, as it's been for so many years over at Epcot in Future World. It's an attraction I've enjoyed over the years. It has sort of suffered from some issues here and there, often, cars coming to a stop throughout the attraction, or certain effects not working, this and that, but that's bound to happen in 14 years worth of an attraction going around. But overall, people have certainly enjoyed Test Track. Very much so. In fact, on Friday when I was there riding Test Track for the final time, the line was well over an hour consistently throughout the day. Even the Fast Pass and the single rider lines were fairly long. And so the popularity of the attraction is very obvious. It does remain very consistently popular. And to have it be closed for the duration of the summer months, one of the busiest times of year at Walt Disney World, is certainly going to be an interesting experience over there. But Disney is promising some additional entertainment throughout that portion to hopefully ease the transition time for when Test Track is becoming the new variation of the ride. Of course, the high-speed area around the building is sure to remain, along with a lot of the turns within the building, but you may not have the bumpiness and the brake tests and all of that. It's surely going to be a different experience when it reopens, probably in September, October, maybe even November. We'll have to wait and see when it is returning. But of course, before Test Track was at Walt Disney World, at Epcot, there was a different attraction in that same spot, and that would be World of Motion. And I wouldn't want to say goodbye to the existing version of Test Track today without also reminiscing a bit on World of Motion as well. So I wanted to share just a quick bit of music here to remember the old World of Motion by, of course, the theme song to World of Motion, It's Fun to Be Free, and that's what I want to share with you right now.
It's fun to be free, to be on the move, to go anywhere with never a care, to do all there is to be done. It's fun to be free, I am. It's fun to be free, to be on the move, to ride or to hike, wherever you like to. Thrill to this beautiful land. Ah, is everybody happy? You'll see what heaven can be. It's fun to be free.
Yeah. And it kind of got cut off there at the end. Sorry about that. But regardless, you get the point. That indeed was the music from the old World of Motion, which many still miss over at Epcot. We'll see if the new a cappella singers that'll be supposedly debuting tomorrow over there will be singing that song or not. Many fans are hoping that they do. So before we get to our last segment here on this week's show, listener feedback, I do want to put in a quick word about Lanyard Lab. If you have a business to promote, or church or a school where you need to wear name tags or use ID cards, maybe around a convention you need to wear something around your neck, get custom lanyards. Definitely a great way to show off your company name or your organization name by having custom print around your neck. You can do that by visiting lanyardlab.com. Fill out the quote request form there, submit that to us with all your design information. We'll email you back with a price quote for your design, along with a proof showing you what the lanyards will look like. And from there, you can place your order online. There's no obligation to purchase, completely free to preview, so check it out at lanyardlab.com. That's LanyardLab.com.
Hey, Ricky.
Hi, Ricky.
Hi, Ricky.
Hey, Ricky.
Hi, Ricky.
Hi, Ricky.
Hey, Ricky.
Ricky, this is amazing.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls,
inside the magic
listener feedback. We started the show with some Test Track, and then we went to Tron because of ElecTRONica ending today. Then we went back to Test Track because Test Track is closing today, and now we're back to some Tron music once again because in the end, I'm actually more upset about ElecTRONica going away at Disney California Adventure than I am about Test Track closing. Test Track, I think, has had a nice long run, and it's not really going away. It's just kind of getting a makeover, whereas ElecTRONica is going away forever, and the mad tea party thing that Disney's putting into Disney California Adventure simply is not going to be the same. It might be fun, but it's not going to be Tron, and I'm not happy about that. But at least you can head over to our website and check out the tribute to that. But anyway, here we are, listener feedback. Let's run through some emails here to wrap up the show. First up is an email from RJ, who writes, just a quick thanks for responding to my water park question in show 362, and to the shout out to my cousin Court. Court and I are actually just returned from the Disneyland Resort, and I wanted to let you and your listeners know that Disneyland so far is not enforcing fast pass return times. I know it was brought up in the last couple of shows. We were able to use a 6:05 to 7:05 pass at 10 p.m. on Space Mountain. Well, RJ, that certainly goes right in line with everything else that everybody's been saying from Disneyland, that while Walt Disney World is now enforcing those return times at the on your Fast Pass, that you have to return within that window. Any later than that, it won't work anymore. Disneyland is still offering that same leniency that the parks have been having for so many years now. So good to continue to get some confirmation on that. Next up, an email from Phil, who writes, just wanted to make sure that you and all the Inside the Magic listeners were aware of a great virtual Disney World. There's a game on the PC that you may be aware of called Minecraft, and it's basically a game where you can create anything in an open world using blocks, almost like virtual Legos. Well, some people have formed together to make a Disney World where you can go around to the parks and ride the rides. It is mind-blowing how much detail was put into this. You can download Minecraft at minecraft.net and then join the server mcdisney.us. So far, they have the Magic Kingdom done and are working on Epcot. It still has some glitches, but overall is very good. Phil, thanks for that heads up. I have checked it out, not playing Minecraft, but I saw some video of it, and definitely an impressive undertaking to sort of rebuild all of Walt Disney World in a online building game environment. Next, an email from Sean was letting me know that a recent article, as he writes, in the Orlando Sentinel described a competition held by the Florida Association of the American Institute of Architects in which the Magic Kingdom's Cinderella Castle was chosen as one of Orlando's four most important buildings and as one of Florida's top 100. Well, Sean, good to know there. I would certainly hope that it would be Cinderella Castle, one of the most iconic structures really on the planet. Certainly something that is instantly recognizable for just about anybody when they see it. So I would hope the American Institute of Architects would classify it as being an important structure. Next up, an email from Evan, who writes, a few things about the new Fantasyland. First of all, I was wondering, with the closing of Snow White's Scary Adventures, if Disney is just going to put those animatronics in the new Seven Dwarves Mine Train, or if they're going to go to the expense of possibly making more lifelike animatronics. I was also wondering if you knew what Disney does with closed park attraction props like animatronics, and if it is possible to purchase any of them. Finally, I was wondering if the Little Mermaid ride at the Magic Kingdom is going to be virtually identical to the one at California Adventure, or if it will feature some new scenes. Evan, great questions there. Certainly we are approaching some important times in New Fantasyland. Snow White's Scary Adventure is going to be closing at the end of next month, so definitely everybody should go out there and ride that while you can. And it's not clear as to whether Disney's just going to move over those, you can barely even call them animatronics as they barely move in the attraction, if they're going to put those into the mine area of the new attraction, or if they're going to have all new ones. Disney has not said that yet. I imagine it'll be a sort of a mixture of both. There probably will be some new effects, new animatronics, new scenery, all of that kind of thing. There will be plenty of that in the new attraction, but I have a feeling they'll mix in some bits of the old one as well. With regards to where you can purchase old attraction pieces, our sponsor, of course, Theme Park Connection. I'm not getting paid to say this part, but they do have a lot of that sort of thing. Signs that come out of old attractions, you know, animatronics. Occasionally they do get, I believe they got the Timothy Mouse from atop the old Dumbo, and other things like that. So that's definitely one of a few places you could get items like that. As far as Little Mermaid ride, it is essentially going to be the same out here in Orlando as it is at Disney California Adventure. Apparently they're making some tweaks, some improvements to it, but for the most part, it's going to be more or less the same attraction. Here's a rather long email that is in response to last week's rather long email, but kind of fun that we're having this discussion here on the show, or at least if you're interested in sort of techie things. I'm going to read it now. It's from Joe, who's an online news editor for In Park Magazine. And Joe writes, just finished watching the latest podcast on YouTube, and it was great as every week. You spent, after spending 2 decades in the giant screen and filmed attraction industries as a projectionist, theater director, and journalist, I can tell you that the listener whose letter you read about the film question was dead on. And I have, lost my place. There we are. However, since there are only 5 IMAX projectors currently in operation at North American parks, the 4 used on Soarin' attractions and a conventional IMAX theater in Valley Fair, the whole IMAX argument is pretty much a moot point. The current range of 4K Sony and DLP projectors do a very good job comparing to 35mm film. Universal has pretty much converted the majority of their attractions and stateside parks to digital projection. Cedar Fair is doing the same with old Paramount Action theaters, and new SeaWorld attractions are digital as well. At this point, we can accept that all new film attractions will use digital projection rather than film. But there are 2 key factors that will still keep film in its place. One is a highly skilled group of unionized projectionists, primarily at Disney, and the other is the old "if it's not broken, don't fix it" axiom. In 2006, Disneyland Paris introduced their single projector digital 3D solution at Show West, or rather DLP. See, I get confused with my acronyms there. You meant DLP, not Disneyland Paris. Anyway, the film industry's annual conference in Las Vegas. While there, I asked James Cameron if he and Universal intended on switching Terminator 2 3D to the digital system. He responded, "Why would I? The current film system that's in place has been working perfectly for years. When the projection system, the film print, and the presentation are well maintained, an audience should not be able to tell the difference between film and digital, and in fact should forget that they're watching a film altogether. My favorite theme park film has been working this illusion for years. Many believe it's a stage show with props and audio animatronics with a huge screen in the background on which film and slides are projected. In fact, The American Adventure is the greatest 3D 70mm film ever produced. There are no slides. It's one continual film. The true star is the film and the props and the actors in front of the screen that supplement the film and give it a sense of depth." Joe, definitely an interesting further look at the world of film versus digital and all of that. I'm not sure there is much more to say about the whole concept. I think the point you said, if it's not broken, don't fix it, that's probably sums up why Disney hasn't switched a lot of their World Showcase films to be digital, because, well, it's just there and it works. And if they kept it, went through all the upkeep and kept it clean and all of that, then, and as you said, you probably wouldn't be able to tell the difference. All right, one more email. This comes in from Rachel, who writes, "My question for you and any other listeners, I'm going on my honeymoon in the first week of May, so that's only a couple of weeks from now. I was wondering what activities could make it special. We're on a tight budget, free hotel, courtesy of my parents, military discount tickets, etc. So what free activities are there that would make a honeymoon special? I know about the happily ever after buttons, but what else is there? Thanks. And thanks for a great show." Well, Rachel, certainly an interesting question. I know a lot of listeners have written in the past saying, "Oh, I'm planning my honeymoon trip. What can we book? What can we do? What can we pay for, etc." You're actually asking the opposite: is I'm planning my honeymoon, and what can we do for free? And that's a bit tougher. Of course, Disney wants you to pay for all of the special experiences that they have. You mentioned the happily ever after buttons, and those are certainly a good way to bump into cast members who occasionally will make some extra magic moments for you. It's always good, in my experience, that when you're not even necessarily when you're making reservations, but even call Disney and check on your reservations, whether it's your hotel, your tickets, your dining reservations, and casually kind of drop into the conversation that it is your honeymoon. Then when you arrive and you check in or you sit down for dinner, make sure to mention then that it's your honeymoon, and it's often the case that cast members at those moments can make some magical things happen as well. Let's say you sit down to dinner, maybe you'll all of a sudden have a special dessert brought out to you at the end, or perhaps at check-in they'll bring out something special for you. while you're checking in. Those moments, you know, they're not guaranteed, but it doesn't hurt to mention as often as possible that you are there for your honeymoon, because that is sort of a, you know, it should be at least a once-in-a-lifetime occasion. And Disney will want to make that extra special for you. So that would be my biggest recommendation, is make it well known that that is that you are on your honeymoon. And chances are you'll have at least one special magical moment while you're hopping around and having a good time around the park. So enjoy your honeymoon in just a couple of weeks. And that'll do it for listener feedback this week. And that about wraps up show 367. For the first time in a very long time, I've actually managed to keep the show to about an hour long, which is impressive. I always try to do that every week and yet somehow sneak into an hour 15, hour 20, hour 30, 2 hours, etc. So good to have occasionally my actual goal of an hour long show. Hopefully you enjoyed our trip, final trip on Test Track. As I said, in the coming days at some point I'll be posting a complete sort of tribute to Test Track with more than what you just heard, and those of you watching the video version, more than what you just saw, a sort of more in-depth look at the queue and everything that's been around at Test Track. Of course, everybody's seen it countless times, and there's plenty of video and photos out there online, but I wanted to kind of compile it in my own fashion online in one place, so that in the future, you know, 10, 15 years from now, you can go back and look and sort of get that Test Track experience that you remember from so many years ago. And in addition to Test Track having its final trips around in its current form today, of course, ElecTRONica ending at Disney California Adventure, which I've already posted a tribute to that over at InsideTheMagic.net as well. So you can keep that in your virtual thoughts for so long for the future. Anyway, I want to thank Magical Travel for sponsoring this week's episode of Inside the Magic. You can find out more about their services by visiting magicaltravel.com. And of course, if you're looking for rare and unique theme park items, Disney items particularly, head to themeparkconnection.com, not only for their eBay store where you can buy things online, but also for directions and information about what is available in their physical store here in Winter Garden, Florida, just 15 or 20 minutes north of the Magic Kingdom or so. And visit us over at lanyardlab.com to see all the different styles and custom lanyard options that we have available. You can request a price quote today to receive a free digital preview of your lanyard design. I also want to mention filmgeektweets.com. It's the site that I'm working on with the Dawes brothers, Jeremiah and Josh. We're reviewing movies quite regularly. I'm working my way through the whole Avengers series leading up to the Avengers movie next month, and so much more. So check that out at filmgeektweets.com. And of course, our website, insidethemagic.net, all of our articles and videos and photos and Twitter and Facebook and YouTube and all that good stuff. So now I want to say thanks to all of you for listening each and every week. Have a magical week. Bye. There's a great big beautiful tomorrow, just a dream away.